Hey, you're listening to the 5 for 5 show from Boombox Music Talk.
I remember when I was very young watching Bret do drum solo at a show at the Arcadia in Tyler, Texas, around the square right there. And as soon as he finished that solo.
Is that the old theater?
Yep.
Yeah.
Hopping up on his stool, you know, throwing the drumsticks out. And they just happened to go to a couple of girls that were right in front of me that I was sitting with the whole show. And I thought, I'm cool. I'm old. I'm with these chicks.
Yeah.
And they were like, ooh, we want to meet that drummer. We got his stick.
And we got his
stick. And I was like, Bret's going to think I'm so cool. I'm hooking up with some girls. And I don't think he was excited about it as much whenever it happened. But I tried to get him backstage. It was a really funny experience for me.
That's funny.
I was like, yeah, I'm cool. I'm
what a rock star moment brother. For you. Yeah, yeah, exactly. As the younger brother.
Yeah, I had a 7-year-old pimp.
He's
what I bring
always,
to the table.
He was always been a pimp.
Welcome to Boombox Music Talk. I'm Mark.
And I'm Krish.
And today on the 5 for 5 show, we have part 2 of Under the Influence with my brother Bret, right?
Brother Bret.
Yeah.
Bret.
And it's funny to hear him tell it. You know, the last episode, it was all about the spectacle and the show and being a rock star.
Being cool, yeah.
Yeah.
Just wanted to be a rock star.
This is how you know the difference. If you watch Bret play, or the side that I got to see, is like, you know, he talks about, you know, just playing like Tommy Lee and swinging his arms around, just looking cool, man. Doesn't matter what he's playing.
Doesn't matter if he's hitting the right cadence.
Yeah, because you can do that when you're jamming. But when you got to start buckling down to play technical stuff and learn things that you're not used to being able to do, his face goes from doing like cool, puckered lip, rock star, rock out, to kind of slightly parted lips, eyes wide open, not looking at anything in the world, but just threw everything inside of his own head and just kind of.
All glory to the Hypnotoad.
Like zombie,
frozen.
I'm going to play. Yeah. My body's doing all kinds of stuff.
Like autopilot.
But
yeah.
His brain is just like concentrating so hard on that thing because it's not as natural,
see
right?
Smoke coming out of his ears.
Yeah. Exactly.
Let's get him out of here.
But it finally broke down. We got to pick him up from behind the kid, go lay him down in the car. He'll wake up in about 15
He's
minutes.
He's overheated.
He's catatonic.
You got to give him a minute.
Yeah.
Catatonic.
And I think that's probably part of, you know, he and I are similar that way where, you know, he wants to be good, but that's not
Might
what he's doing it for,
just,
you know.
Yeah,
he wants to be able to play the cool stuff, and that's why he's doing the good stuff.
Yeah.
Not doing the good stuff just because he wants to be super good at his craft. You know
right.
what I'm saying?
Not doing the technical stuff because he wants to be good at his craft. I mean, he does, but
yeah.
more so, he would rather be cool.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
And look cool.
Yep, yep.
Yeah.
So it's fun on this episode to dive into that technical side of things a little bit because I'm not a super technical person either that way. And so I was curious to hear kind of what influences brought him to that point to get
yeah.
out of that rock star kind of way of thinking into.
And what technical avenues to pursue even.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Because there's lots of options.
Yeah, no, that's true.
You can be easily, or one can be easily overwhelmed by those options. So
yeah.
it's interesting to hear the direction he chose and why.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Yep. Well, you know, whenever you're younger, you think you can do everything, and you learn a little bit, and you...
Even when you're older, you think you can, but you can't.
Yeah. Yeah.
Just kidding.
Absolutely. But it was really fun to be able to sit down with him and go through these and kind of pay tribute to him a little bit, because my whole life, I could never really repay him for what he's been able to do for me, you know, starting whenever I was playing competitive sports and he was doing kinesiology. He wrote a big training program for me out, you know?
Yeah.
Fast forward to being able to play in the bands and record and do all this stuff, because he was helping financially make that happen and be a stable influence in that picture.
Well, a stable supporter.
Yeah.
You know, to
let that come out.
I mean, people can make it on by themselves 100%, but man, it's a hard road. And, you know, to be able to have that one influence that's been a stable supporter, I mean, essentially your whole life.
Yeah.
You know, and
I mean, gave me my career, you know, like I was through an opportunity that he helped provide, because we're in the same career of recruiting, and that wouldn't happen if he wasn't there to do that, you know, even to getting in bar fights when we were playing in shows. Yeah, I swear he, you know, and he used to bounce whenever he was in college too. And he's not a big dude at all, but he just goes into this weird, crazy mode. And
well, all you got to do is Crazy Eyes.
Yeah, I know. Yes. My dad was a big fan of Crazy Eyes.
Yes, he
taught us that well.
I'm a Crazy Eyes killer.
Even towards the end, man, it was so funny.
But he would, I would no doubt start something with somebody, or usually defending somebody else, but I just can't deal with, you know, a-holes in the bars. You have a lot of them.
Yeah.
And but I'm up there in the mic and I'm not taking it. And so I'd start something with somebody, and Bret, before I could even get down to start fighting somebody, would be out from behind the drums,
like lightning,
already down, you know, in front of the stage. I'm like,
how'd you get there so fast?
Yeah.
He's like, I'm still drumming.
He drummed the whole way over there.
He's like, that's how I beat him up by drumming.
Yeah.
Use my drumming superpower.
Uh-huh. He got there and he did the martial arts called drum foo.
Yeah.
He's drum
foo
really
you.
Exactly.
So what I'm saying, actually, you see, I mean, it's a combination of both. I mean, here it is, the natural instinct, and here is control. You are to combine the two in harmony. Not if you have one to the extreme, you will be very unscientific. If you have another to the extreme, you become all of a sudden a mechanical man, no longer a human being. So it is a successful combination of both. So therefore, it's not pure naturalness or unnaturalness. The ideal is unnatural naturalness or natural unnaturalness.
Yin yang, eh?
You're right, man. That's it.
In the end, you know, getting down, and this is all going chronological, it's not a favorites for him, but getting down to that number one spot, we get to see the balance that comes out of all this. And I think that's ultimately where he's happiest, because that's what he is. He's just a very kind of zen,
balanced,
steady person. He's not going to get super extremes.
Yeah. He probably is triggered by, you know, certain situations.
Hey, how come Andrew gets to get up?
That's right.
If he gets up, we'll all get up. It'll be anarchy.
But generally speaking, you know, like you were talking about with the band thing, but generally speaking, like, you know, it's pretty even keel like that.
Yep. Yeah, exactly.
He uses his energy to be funny and to drum.
We'll be right back.
Yep.
That's exactly it. So, hope you guys enjoy part two. We'll go ahead and get this rolling. I'm Mark.
And I'm Krish.
And we urge you to enjoy the journey.
And stay zen.